Assalamu alaikum, dear students. I hope you all would be fine. So, welcome back to social psychology. So, where we left with chapter number 5. We almost covered the half part of the chapter, only half and one topic is remaining now. So, the fifth chapter is attitudes. We already covered and discussed that what attitude is, evaluating and responding to the social world. Attitude is nothing but our evaluation about something. How do we think about something? Do we have a positive evaluation about something or the negative? Whatever evaluation we have about something, then we respond to that accordingly. So we have covered this part of the chapter in our last classes where we left before COVID-19. So we covered the attitude formation, in which we covered the classical conditioning, how our attitude is developed. Our attitude is developed with the classical conditioning, with instrumental conditioning, where we talk about the reward for the right, and we talk about how we can do the instrumental conditioning. Observational learning, sometime our attitude is being developed. Whatever we observe, whatever is exposed to us by the world, then we create certain attitude about that. These topics were already discussed through the lecture discussion and the drama that we did in the class. So now the only one topic is remaining for this chapter, so that is the how do attitude guide behavior. What is the link between attitudes and the behavior? So we talk about this now. So now first part is how do attitude guides our behavior. I mean, what is the link of the attitude and behavior? What do you think? A lot of people have a very strong link of the attitude and the behavior. Let's suppose my attitude about smoking is very bad. I evaluate smoking in a bad way, so my behavior is not having smoking. So my attitude and behavior has a strong link, right? So sometimes the link of the attitude and behavior is stronger, sometimes the link of the attitude and behavior is weaker. Sometimes people may not like to smoke, but it has become their habit. So though their evaluation of the smoking is bad, but yet they are having it, their actions are performing it. That means their relationship of the attitude and behavior is weak. So we will talk more about further. Now we can say that attitude is one of the predictor of the behavior. If someone have a very negative attitude about the politics, so we can predict that they may not indulge in any political action in the future. So we are predicting the behavior of that person by looking at his or her attitude. Sometimes we see in our surroundings some people talk more about, you know, co-education is very good, we should promote it. So we can predict their attitude about co-education is positive. So we can predict that he would allow his or her kid to go for co-education, and he would perform certain actions, perform certain behaviors that is supported by the co-education, right? So we see furthermore and other examples. Let's suppose if I do not like smoking, my attitude of smoking is bad, so I won't smoke. If I like, my attitude about charity work is positive, so I would perform the charity work and I give charity to the hospital, maybe the charitable institutions, and I support that because my attitude is positive about that. So here your attitude is the predictor of the behavior. Now I gave one of the example that stated attitude. Sometimes we state a lot of things. We stated that I don't like this, I like this. So we state a lot of things. So stated attitude may not predict the actual behavior. Now here is the discussion. I'm giving the example of one of the famous research. The Lapre did one of the research in 1939 in the field of psychology. He wrote one of the article, Attitude versus Action. So Lapre traveled 2 years with Chinese couple by car, 2 years in America. In 1939, American people were having a very, you know, not very good attitude about the Asian people, means Chinese people or the other Asian people. So he just wanted to know if people having a negative attitude about the Asian people, so what are their actions? So he did a research about that. So he traveled 2 years with the Chinese couple. In that trip, they visited almost 25 restaurants and hotels in 2 years. All of them served the Chinese couple except one, whatever hotel number they visited, 251. Means all the 251 restaurants served those Chinese couple, except only one hotel. Later on, once he finished all his trip, so he came back home and he did a survey, and he did survey and sent the questionnaire to the people, to the restaurant, 251 restaurant where he visited. He asked a questionnaire, would you like to serve to the Asian people? The interesting finding were almost 93% of the people said no for the Asian people. Means they stated no for the Asian people, but in real their action was different. During the trip to the America by car for 2 years, all the people of the American restaurant served the Chinese couple, only except one. So here we can conclude that stated attitude may not predict the actual behavior. Through this study, we conclude that people are, you know, stating that they do not like to serve to the Asian people, but in real, they serve them. So their stated behavior was not predicting the actual behavior. So let's go ahead. How do attitudes guide behavior? So we learn two mechanisms through which attitude guides behavior, right? So one is the attitudes based on the reason thought. Sometimes we have to perform certain actions with the proper reasoned thought. The other method or mechanism through which attitude guides behavior is the spontaneous behavior. We call it the spontaneously behavior responses that we do very quickly, you know, the spontaneous speech, means without preparation, and you didn't done it very quickly without certain planning, a very genuine, quick and natural response, spontaneously behavior response, right? So we discussed two of the mechanism through which a lot of time attitude guides our behavior, right? So the first attitude arrived at through the reasoned thought. In some situation, we give careful and deliberate thought to our attitudes. And then we think, should we do the behavior or not? We have certain thing and we carefully evaluate it. That we call the theory of reasoned action. Later on, that theory is called the theory of planned behavior. A lot of time, whenever we have time, we are not very in hurry, or we are not in a short of time, we perform some behavior in a very pre-planning way. We thought everything. So It means decision to engage in a particular behavior is the result of rational process. I mean, you know about this. What is the rational process? Whenever we are going to perform any behavior, we follow the rational process. What is the rational process? Various behavior options are considered. I mean, whenever we are going to perform any behavior, we have various behavior options. And we also see the consequences and outcomes of each behavior is evaluated. Means if I perform this behavior, what would be the outcome? If I perform that behavior, then what would be the outcome? So we follow the rational process. The third one that we follow, the decision to act or not. In the reason thought process, we carefully, deliberately undergo with the rational process. We evaluate a lot of behaviors, we evaluate their consequences, then we conclude, should we act or not act? So we have the time to think all about this, right? So let's see further how we are going to see. So behavioral intention, through this whole process, what we are going to make, we are creating the behavioral intentions. Behavioral intentions is the good predictors of your actual behaviors. How? So let's see further what is the behavioral intention. So if the intention behavior relationship is even stronger when people have formed the plan. So research says when intention behavior become more stronger when people make a plan. How? So let's have a look to the example. Let's suppose you make an intention to go to shopping, right? So your attitude to go for shopping is positive and you are going to create the intention behavior. You make a list, you plan it, you make a proper list of shopping and you ask your mother to join you. So you are here doing a proper planning. And once, if you may skip or you may forget to go for shopping, so your mother is here to remind you. Now your mother will remind you, we have to go for shopping. So here you are giving control to the situation to make you recall. The other example, let's see. Intention to go for the gym. If you are making an intention to go for gym, so you have sort of plan. You took out exercise clothes, you set an alarm to go for the gym. You do proper planning to do these all things. So that's the intention behavior, right? I mean, this is what we call, we are planning to implement our actions. We are, you know, planning to implement our actions, intentions. Here we are delegating control to the situation. In above situation, we give control to the mother. Now here, mother, we give, delegate the authority to mother to, you know, make us recall we have to go. So we are, you know, converting our intention, implementing our intention to our behavior, actual behavior. And in this situation example, intention to go for gym, here we give control, delegate control to the alarm. Alarm is here to make us awake for the exercise or the gym. So that's called the implementation plan. Whatever intentions we have, so we are going to have the behavior accordingly. So this all called the thought and reason process. Okay, model of the intentions. And so there are a lot of factors, right? I mean, sometimes we may follow the behavior. We have certain attitude about something and then we perform certain behavior. But there are a lot of factors that help us out, that strengthen the relationship of the attitude and the behavior. So this model contains three things that we talk now. and I will also give the example. I would first define first I would define the terms, then I would give the example, right? So the first term, one of the factor that strengthen the relationship of the attitude and behavior is the attitude. What is our attitude about something? Is it a positive or a negative? Right. Then the other factor is your subjectivity norms. You know the norm, subjectivity norm. Will other people approve or disapprove? Will the society accept it or not? And this is also one of the factor that help you to strengthen relationship between attitude and behavior. The third thing is the perceived behavioral control. What is the behavioral control? Means your ability to demonstrate something, whatever you are having attitude about, right? So I've got one of the example here. So your attitude. Now one of the thing that I am going to go as giving to charity. Okay, that's the mistake. Giving charity to affected place of the Africa. So there one of the place in Africa. Let's assume that there is a flood in Africa. So one of the place of the Africa has been affected. So you have the attitude about that place, right? Your attitude about that place means you are very charitable person. So you support charitable things. So your attitude about giving charity to that place is positive. You wanted to give that Africa place the sort of charity, right? Now you are living in Pakistan, and subjectivity norm. Now I would be defining how subjectivity norm affect your behavior. Now you find your office colleagues, you have positive attitude here. Now you find a lot of office colleagues are giving a charity to that affected place of the Africa. So you find that now they are giving, they are approving it, they are accepting it, they are influencing your behavior that you should give too, though you have a positive attitude. Maybe you are supporting to give charity to your native place people, right? But now your all colleagues are giving charity to that affected place. Now they are influencing you to give the charity to that affected area of Africa, right? So the other factor that we would be discussing here is sort of perceived behavior. Now what is perceived behavior? What is your ability to do something? Now, do you have money to give? If you don't have money to give, so either you have a positive attitude, people are, you know, supporting you, people are, you know, influencing you to give charity to that place. But you are having a no money, means you have no behavioral control. So you are unable to perform that behavior. So if you have a positive attitude, if I conclude this whole discussion, so I would say there are three major factors. So there may be a lot of factors. There are major three factors that strengthen your relationship of the attitude and behavior. Your attitude is positive about giving charity. People are affecting you. If you have money to give the charity, so that strengthen your behavior. So you have positive attitude and you are also performing certain behavior. So intention model guides us. These are the major three factors that, you know, strengthen the relationship of the attitude and the behavior. So there could be other factors too, like maybe you are busy, you have a lot of work to do, that's why you are unable to give charity a lot of things. But now time we are discussing these are the major factors, right? So let's go ahead. Now the other mechanism through which attitude guides the behavior is the spontaneous behavioral reaction. One was the reason thought, very much planned behavior. The other is very much spontaneous behavior. I mean, what is the spontaneous behavior? Let's see. A lot of time we don't have time to think.
we are short of time. We have a very less time to think. We quickly respond. A lot of time this happens. Sometimes, let's see, in many situations people have to act quickly. Their reactions are more spontaneously in our daily life. Let's suppose you are waiting in the line and someone break your line and passed you by. So you are going to perform certain behavior which is very spontaneously. I mean, you have no time to think, you have to act so quickly. The other example, you are driving and someone cuts you from. I mean, at that time you are getting more aggressive. I mean, what happened? That guy has just crossed me out. I mean, that behavior would be more spontaneously. So we will talk more about this thought of things. So let me take this example. So we have certain event being cut off in traffic. So we are taking one of the second example. If someone cuts you off, so a spontaneous attitude to behavior process affects gives the sort of attitude and the norms. So we are going to give the interpretation to the event. What sort of interpretation we are going to give to that event? If someone has, you know, crossed you off and have someone, you know, cut off in your traffic, so we have certain attitudes and we have certain norm. What is the attitude? According to the attitude to behavior process view, event triggers our attitude, and spontaneously the appropriate norm for how people should or typical do behave in a given situation. So we have certain norm, what is right, what is wrong, how we must behave in particular situation if something happened. In this case, now the situation that we are talking about, in this case the being cut off by traffic by other driver triggers our attitude towards such person and our knowledge that this action is atypical. Now what we are interpreting in turns determine how we behave. The attitude are an important factor in shaping our overt behavior. Now we are interpreting, we have a certain attitudes, we have attitude that this person did something very wrong. I mean, what is the norm? Cutting off in between traffic to someone is very bad thing. So we are evaluating the event. We are interpreting, giving meaning to that event. Now we respond accordingly. If someone having a sort of attitude, maybe he is in hurry. So we started to have the attitude, in hurry people do this thing. They give a sort of norm. Once we are in hurry, people used to do this sort of things. We give an interpretation, then we act accordingly, right? So this is very important things to discuss. Over the period of time, whenever we create the interpretation of something in sort of that event, those all actions become our habits. Those spontaneous, all the responses over the period of time, once we perform certain actions repeatedly, those becomes our habits. So we have to be very careful what sort of event, what sort of interpretation we are giving to that event. Are we a positive or we negative, and so on. So let's see further. You have some automatic behavior requires no intention that we discussed now, that we require no intention. What is appropriate? Shape our definition. What is appropriate? I mean, whatever you are thinking, what should be right, what should be wrong, I mean, this all is going to define how we are going to interpret the situation. Is this a normal behavior that he performed? He cut off from you. I mean, he just cut off from the traffic, in between the traffic. Was that a normal or abnormal? You are trying to give meaning to that, right? So the important thing that I am going to tell you, multiple attitudes, repetitive behavior create habits for tomorrow. Now whatever actions we are going to do are going to create the permanent habits inside us. So a lot of people become more aggressive in a lot of situation because they evaluate situation in a wrong, in a negative way. So they give a definite, they give meaning to that definition in a very, in a very negative. So they act, their behavior is more aggressive. A lot of people who are very calm, who are having a positive mind, who you know, train their brain in a positive way. So they give meaning to that event in a more positive way. Maybe they say, maybe the person is in hurry, they had some emergency situation, that's where they are going. So they are going to give meaning to that event. I mean, that event is creating the habits for the tomorrow behaviors, right? So the other thing that we have to say, can we change attitudes? Yes, we can change attitudes of the people over the period of time. I've got it one of the example. So here is, this is a short video. You can go to this link and you can watch the short video. Very funny, a sort of fun strategy. Here is a fun strategy to encourage more recycling. I mean, in this video you would find there was a little experiment that they did. They conduct an experiment that they wanted to encourage people to recycle their products, right? So they put one of the box in between the street area. A lot of people were throwing the bottles, but the quantity of bottle was not that much. So they did experiment. What they did to get people to recycle their product by making it a fun activity, the experimenters set up the bottle bank with the flashing lights and display, giving the players point for their bottles. Now what they did experiment that we wanted to change the attitude of the people. So they started giving the flashing lights and displayed the points. If one person had one recycled bottle, they would get a 1 point and the flash lights. So that create a sort of positive attitude in the people to recycle the products and their behavior change. So before, a lot of people were not coming and they were not recycling. Once they started having this flashing light and sort of point system, it's create a game for the people, a sort of fun strategy. So that encourage people to come and perform that behavior. I mean, through multiple things we can change our behavior. So that's the end of this this is the end of our chapter. I would suggest you should go through the complete video and we can join in the letter. Thank you very much.